Father, I want to thank you that you're always about persuading our hearts with your faith, showing us constantly who we are to you, how you see us, until our hearts are so persuaded that we are just so in love with you. I thank you, God, that it's not our work. What a freedom it is to know that you are the one that's doing the work, and all we do is hear and let you fill up our hearts. Thank you, Father. Well, this morning, God would like to tell you that he finds no fault in you. And in fact, he's never found fault in you. Recently, he told me that. He said, I find no fault in you, and I have never found any fault in you, but you have found fault in me. And it really kind of caught me off guard. So the next time I have an opportunity to preach, I'm going to preach on the second part of that. But today I'm going to talk about God finds no fault in you. Then he said, the reason that I find no fault in you is because I have always known you as you truly are. Now, isn't that amazing? God finds no fault in you because he has known you as you truly are. Do you know what that means? That means that you don't know yourself as you truly are, and probably nobody else that's ever been in your life knows you as you truly are. It's important to know why God finds no fault in us. If we don't know the foundation that God reasons from, what's going to begin to happen is we will begin to reason from our own minds, and that equals trouble. I was taught that the reason that God found no fault in me was because he put me in a Jesus suit. The real me, who I really was hidden in Jesus, so God could stand to look at the real me. Now, do you think that brought me a lot of peace? Not really. At first, it seemed like it did. It was better than thinking God hated me. It told me, well, at least God had an answer so he could stand to look at me. He came up with a solution. But it still told me that God was not pleased with me. If God has to hide me in Jesus, that says to me that I am so ugly that he can't stand to look at me. It told me that God did find fault with the real me. So we have to understand and have an assurance of what God's foundation is and his reasoning about us. We're going to see that in Ephesians 1:4. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, years ago, I thought that in him meant that I was in the Jesus suit. And so that's why God could stand to look at me. But that is not what it means. That little word in, this is what it means in the original text. It denotes a fixed position, a relation of rest, and listen to this, denoting origin. That means we already were like God. Our origin comes from God. That's why we're in him. And then without blame means unblemished and faultless. So from the beginning, God has seen you and me as we truly are. He saw us in the Trinity, in him, not to hide from the real us, but because we belong with him. We're one with him. God saw us in the Trinity because that's where we belonged. It's not like God made a worm and then he elevated the worm to a place of a higher species. That's what I was taught. I know some of you all were taught that too. That we were worms, and somehow along the way, God put us in a Jesus suit and elevated us to a better place. But originally, our origin is God's image. That's what your origin is God's image. God placed you in a relationship of equality with him so that he could be one with you, free from fear, from guilt and shame when you were in his presence. So we were all created to be a part of the Trinity because that's who we are. God always saw you perfect. In fact, he saw you so perfect that he gave up what he valued most to get you back. And we see that in Matthew chapter 13, verses 45 through 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who when he had found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Now that word kingdom talks about rule and royalty. And heaven is God's abode, or by implication, happiness, power, eternity, and especially the gospel. So we could say that the kingdom of heaven is God's way of living, his way of believing, his way of doing things, and what things are most important to him. So let's look at what things are most important to God. What is he going about doing? Seeking goodly pearls. That's what it says. That's what he's going about doing. Now think about all the things that God could do in the whole universe. What he's doing is he's looking for goodly pearls. The merchant is God. And that word merchant means to travel, to trade. And then it's kind of unusual that they call him a merchant man. The definition for the word man is man-faced, a human being. So what is that saying? God is man-faced. God is also human. How amazing. If you are made in God's image, that means God's image is like you also, right? Yes. So the merchant's time and his heart and his mind is filled with looking after and finding these goodly pearls. Why? Because that is what's most important to him. That word seek means to go about, desire, endeavor, inquire, and require. Isn't it amazing? God required us to be able to have all the joy that he wanted for his own life. You needed to be a part of him for him to have that. He's seeking after goodly pearls. That means beautiful, good, valuable, virtuous, and worthy. He's not looking for ugly pearls. He's not looking for pearls that are worthless. He's not looking for bad pearls. Who is the pearl of great price? You. You are the pearl of great price. That word great means extremely valuable, very costly, especially of the highest degree, the dignity of itself, honor, and precious. That's what God sees when he sees you. When the merchant found the pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had to buy it. Sometimes we hear the gospel so much that that can just go right over our heads. Yeah, we know Jesus came and he died on the cross and it bought us back, redeemed us from the enemy's belief system. But think about it. What does that say about you? God was willing to give up Jesus so he could get you. That's something that as we meditate on that, man, you get so filled up with God's love. And God is wanting to persuade our hearts all the time. This is what he's saying to us all the time. This is what I feel about you. This is what I think of when I think about you. The value that God places on you is equal to the value that he places on Jesus. God never saw fault in you. What God saw was his child, who was a victim that was caught in Satan's belief system. Did you hear that? He did not see somebody that had disobeyed and messed up, and now he's aggravated with them because now he's got to do something to clean up their mess. That's not what God saw. God saw something beautiful, as valuable as Jesus, something that was precious to him. His child caught in a trap that they couldn't get out of by themselves. This is kind of a simple little picture of it. I have a beautiful butterfly, and they're caught in a spider web. Now, I have to ask you one thing. Is the butterfly still beautiful? Do you see any fault in the butterfly? Does the butterfly need to be made more beautiful to have value and worth? No. What's the problem? The butterfly is caught in a web, and they can't get out. That's a picture of us. That's what God saw. He saw his beautiful creation, those that he planned to spend his lifetime with, eternity with, one in the Godhead, caught in the belief system of the devil, and they couldn't get out. He couldn't let his children stay in that trap and die in that belief system. So he said, let me send myself. Let me send myself, and I will free my children. God never quits seeing you as perfect. Now, sometimes that's difficult for us to get our minds around. Why is that? Well, it's because God sees everything you do, right? So if you see everything you do and God sees everything you do, there might be a little problem there, right? That's because you see yourself according to the flesh. God has never seen you according to the flesh. To help us get our minds and our hearts around that, we want to really realize what it means when we see ourselves in the flesh. So, I want to ask you, who is it that sees you according to the flesh? Who is it that first saw you according to the flesh? Satan, the accuser. Do we now think that God and Satan have the same belief system? Are we saying that now God has been corrupted also in what he sees? And that he's looking at us in the flesh like Satan does? No, absolutely not. There is no way. God never brought the flesh system because he never agreed with the flesh system. He's never judged you according to what you do or what you don't do. It isn't that God saw you ugly, so Jesus came to change you. You know, I lived years under that system. The whole point of being a Christian was to let God just come with a piece of sandpaper and just burn your hide off till you finally look just like him. And he did it in lots of ways, and most of them weren't very nice either. So sometimes it's hard for us to get our brains to move from the enemy's belief system to what God's belief system is. But God never saw the problem was you. God saw the problem just like that spider web. He saw the problem was that you were caught in a system of believing that you couldn't get out of by yourself. Satan tricked Adam and Eve into believing and defining themselves according to the flesh. He tricked them into getting their value and worth from their behavior. And that's what was passed down to the world. I think that's what it means when it talks about the fallen world. You know, we live in a fallen world. It's that this whole world system is under that lie that your identity and who you are is what you do or what you don't do or what you have or what's happened to you. But that was never God's intention. God's dream for you was to define you according to who he is and what God says about himself and nothing else. When man started defining himself according to the flesh, what did he see? Well, let me give you a little hint. What does it say about the flesh? It's weak, right? So if you start defining yourself in the flesh, what you're going to see is you're going to see failure. And you're going to experience shame and guilt. Because the enemy's belief system was a system of failure. It was a system to kill us. Our flesh was never the system that God intended for us to live by. God knew the flesh was weak. So God set about to destroy the belief system that the enemy had planted in the garden because it was killing his children. What is that belief system? We all know it. We've heard it probably a million times in this church. But I'm going to say it again because it tries to attach itself to each one of us many times every day. Satan's belief system says that you are defined by what you do and what you don't do. So that means every time you judge yourself according to the flesh, looking at something you've done, you're in the wrong belief system. Now that happens many times a day. But at the same time, while that's going on and the world is pressing in on us and that belief system is pressing in on us, there's another belief system that is persuading our hearts. It's God, the Holy Spirit. And he's saying continually, I find no fault in you. You are worthy. You are precious to me. And he will continue to do that until our hearts are fully persuaded. God never wanted you to enter into a system that would cause you to think bad about yourself. I want you to think about that for a minute because we're going somewhere with it. God never wanted you to enter into a system that would cause you to think bad about yourself. He never wanted you to judge yourself according to the flesh. He never wanted you to feel guilt or shame. None of those things come from God. None of them bring life. They all bring death. If that is true, and it is, why, oh why, would God give us the Ten Commandments to make us feel worse about ourselves? It makes no sense. And you know, when we look at something in this church and it makes no sense, we start digging around and we say, there's some lie in there. There's something not right. Let's get God's persuasion. Let's let him persuade our hearts deeper in another way, in a more full way, so we can get a full picture of what the faith of the Son of God says. If God never wanted us to define ourselves by our flesh, why would he give us the Ten Commandments so we could judge ourselves according to the flesh? So now it makes you start wondering, doesn't it? He gave the Ten Commandments to prevent us from making the same mistake that Adam and Eve made. He gave us the commandments to show us not to trust in our own strength. He wanted us to know that we could live according to his life and not our own lives, not our own flesh. If we believe that God gave us the Ten Commandments to show us how bad we are, that is like God helping us eat the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I really want to take this to the full extent so we can really see what's going on and what that says. That's like God saying, let me show you that I will never forsake you by forsaking Jesus. when he died on the cross. That didn't make sense either, did it? But how many years did we believe that? So this is another thing. We've been taught that the Ten Commandments were given to us to show us what worms we were. That's how I heard the gospel. That's the gospel that was preached to me. You are such a worm. Look at all these things that you can't do. Looking at the flesh, feeling like you're a failure, guilt and shame. Remembering that guilt and shame is never where God wanted us to be. If God never saw you bad, why would he give you something to make you look bad? Man, lots of good questions here. They didn't come from me. God was asking me all these questions. And I had to say, wow, you know, there's something here. God, just keep showing me, keep showing me. If God never judged you according to the flesh, and he never wanted us to judge ourselves according to the flesh, why would he give us the Ten Commandments as a standard by which we would judge ourselves by our actions? They can't both be true. Either God wanted us to know ourselves by who he is or according to the flesh. Where did that system of judging ourselves according to the flesh come from? Satan. Are we saying that God put us under Satan's belief system? I don't think so. God came and showed Adam and Eve the system to live in so that they could have life. They were never supposed to find their identity in their flesh or what they did. God never wanted them to trust in their own strength for life. He wanted them to trust in him and his grace, his good view and opinion of them. You know, grace existed before Adam and Eve fell. It wasn't something that was just there after they fell. It was the system that God intended for all of us to live in right from the very start. Your warfare is not against the flesh. Your flesh is going to stay flesh. It's weak. Your fight is against the belief that you define yourself by anything other than the image of Jesus, him resurrected from the dead, seated at the right hand of God. We were all supposed to find our identity in Jesus. Why? Because that is who we already were like. Now, if that's true, if we're already like Jesus, why would God send us something that would make it look like we're not like Jesus? Another good question. Your wrong actions cannot define you. That is what Satan believes. Satan and God don't agree, right? They do not agree. If we think God finds fault in us, then we're saying that he's agreeing with Satan. Now, I'm going to give you a picture to help you understand this. And it's what God gave to me. I wrestled all week with this, saying, God, give me a picture. Because when you've believed a certain system for 30 and 40 years, when God comes and says, I didn't give you that system for this reason, your head kind of goes tilt and you go, I don't understand. Surely I see, God, that the two things aren't matching up. But I still couldn't get my hand around it. So this is what God showed me. Now, this is a piece of lettuce. Now, this piece of lettuce is good in some places. But in some places, it's kind of starting to rot. But if you put this piece of lettuce into a salad with other pieces of lettuce, you probably would not even notice that they're part of it's bad, and you'd go ahead and eat it because you wouldn't have the full impact in your senses of what you were eating. That's what it was like for God's children before the Ten Commandments came. They didn't see that they were dying under the devil's belief system. They thought they were getting life. The fools thought that they could obey the Ten Commandments. Hey, I joined the ranks. I thought I could too, and I spent a whole lifetime trying to find myself doing it, and I found out that I couldn't, just like everybody else finds. However, if I give you this, which is a full head of rotting lettuce, and I give you this bowl of lettuce for your salad, you're going to go, oh my gosh, I'm not going to eat that. That'll make me sick. In fact, it might kill me. You wouldn't have anything to do with it. You would run from it. That's what God intended when the Ten Commandments were given. Oh my gosh, this is death. I don't want any part of this. I'm going to run to God. That's what was going on. God was trying to free us, not have us be put under Satan's belief system. But you know what? Amazingly, we ate the bowl of rotten lettuce, didn't we? That's what we did. We memorized those Ten Commandments. We studied them and we found out what they meant. And we did everything we could to just gobble up each and every morsel of it until we were sick and tired and dying. Yes, all I have to do is try a little harder. Try a little harder. Try a little harder. God wants us free. He wants us free from the flesh system. Now, well-meaning people that were also caught in the web taught us that God wanted us to feel bad about ourselves. He used guilt and shame to take the sin out of our life. Did that work for you all? It did not work for me. And I tell you what, I can remember one time. This is how, you know, the enemy isn't just cruel. He is extremely cruel. His belief system was meant to torture us. A slow death. So he takes that flesh system and he just takes it to the 100th degree. So I remember about 30 years ago, sitting in a chair, I had a big struggle with sweets. And I sat in the chair and I had this big old Hershey's chocolate bar with almonds. And I said, do I love God more or do I love this Hershey bar more? And guess what I did? I gobbled up that Hershey bar as fast as I could. Yeah, man, that flesh is weak. And I tortured myself. The reason I remember it happening is because of how long I tortured myself. In fact, I would probably say I tortured myself until I started coming to this church and I started having my heart persuaded that this is not the way that God wants us to live. He does not want us living self-absorbed, looking at our own navels, our own flesh, using this demonic standard that we have to try to live up to. That is not what God has for us. So I was taught under this belief system by the church that they were caught in the same web, that when I felt bad about myself, when God accused me of my sin, you know, the Holy Spirit was the accuser instead of the comforter under this system, that he would come and he would show me my sin so I would feel so guilty and so shameful. And I would feel like a worm. And then I would crawl to God. And you know, I did crawl to God. I crawled on my hands and my knees as a worm. I did not go boldly into the throne room of God, believing God loved me. I went in crawling, believing that God was disgusted with me and unhappy with me. And how could he possibly love me? That's not God's life. That is not the way God wants us to live. And I was taught that because God was merciful and because he was good, he would have pity on me and he would take my poor, pathetic self back. But you know, I didn't have peace there either. It was always that, yeah, God took me back, but it was kind of because he had no choice but to take me back, because after all, he was God. And so he was good, and so he had to do it. There was not a feeling of God loved me. The only time I felt that God loved me after I got under the law system was when I did everything right. Not very often. Not very often. I couldn't feel God's love hardly at all. And when you think about it, Ephesians 3 says that God wants us to experience the length and depth and the height and breadth of his love until we're filled with the fullness of God. You cannot experience that under the law system that says that your identity is based on what you do and what you don't do. That is not the gospel. Jesus did not come to show us who we could become. He came to show us who we already were. He came to set us free from that web that said that we were judged by our flesh. Now, Jesus himself came to show us that. He showed us that through his death and burial and resurrection. But he also talked about it when he was on the earth. In Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, it says, when Jesus came into the coasts of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some say Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets. Now, Jesus calls himself the Son of Man for a very specific reason. He is trying to connect his identity with his disciples' identity, his identity with their identity. Jesus came to show us who we really were. The Son of Man means a human being. Jesus said, I am the Son of Man, a human being. Jesus is saying that he's human like we are. Jesus is showing his disciples his humanity so that they can connect to him. Then in verses 15 and 17 it says, Jesus said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter, you know, Peter was always quick to answer. He answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Now let's go back to the original question. The original question that Jesus asked is, who do you say I, the Son of Man, am? Peter says, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. So Peter is saying, you, Jesus, the Son of Man, are also the Son of God. Identical in character. Jesus came to reveal the truth about the human race. Unless we see the human race in Jesus, we will never see the truth about ourselves, or for that matter, anybody else either. God is expressing his belief about the human race in Jesus here. Jesus is saying that he is a human just like we are a human. You know, Jesus is still human. He's seated in heaven at the right hand of the Father with a human body. He has hands and feet And they still have the fingerprints or the nail prints in them, in his hands and in his feet. He still is human, and he still is the Son of God. The Son of Man equaled the Son of God. That's the revelation that Peter was getting. And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." So Peter is making Jesus one with God in this statement. Jesus said, you don't get this except by revelation. This came from God. Isn't that right, y'all? I remember the first time my son said that I was like God, and I just about flipped out. And I said, there is no way, this is heresy. What am I going to do? Man, it has to come by revelation. But you know, that was the first time I had ever heard that. But the Holy Spirit, he took that, and he began persuading my heart week after week after week. Let me show you who you really are. You are not the worm that you always thought you were, and you never have been. You haven't gone through a species transformation. You always were just like me. That was the revelation, that Jesus was the Son of Man and the Son of God. And then comes the humdinger in Matthew 16, 18. And Jesus says unto Peter, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Jesus is saying, I say back to you what you just said to me. You just said that the Son of Man is the Son of God, and I'm saying it back to you. You're the son of Jonah, and you're the Son of God. He tells Peter that he is cut from the same rock that Jesus is cut from. Peter's name actually means rock, and or piece of the rock, and Jesus is the one that gave him that name. And throughout the Bible, God is portrayed as the rock. So this whole time, Jesus is trying to persuade Peter, and then all of us through the scripture, that who Jesus is who we are. Identical. And look at what Jesus says he's going to build his church on. That revelation that God's children, God's sons and daughters, are just like him. And it also says that the devil's belief system isn't going to prevail. Isn't that good news? He's lost. Now, if you want to go into that, the study of those scriptures a little bit more, Greg preached an amazing sermon back in March 3rd of 2013. It's called Binding and Loosing. And he goes into what binding and loosing is. He goes into spiritual warfare, and we have extra CDs on that little small table. So after church, if you'd like to get into that more, we have that available for you. Jesus came to lead people out of the darkness. What darkness? Satan's belief system that we were not like God. When man believed that they were not like God, they were plunged into darkness and into death. When we can see who we really are, we come out of the darkness. We come out of that trap, and we're in the light. Has God ever been in darkness or death? No. He's always known the truth about us. He's always been full of light and life. God has never believed for one second that we were not like him. We need to allow God to persuade our hearts that we are the same as Jesus. Jesus equals you. We see it a lot of times throughout scripture. I'm sure there are a lot of people here that can quote these scriptures. But it's one thing to be able to quote it with your mouth. It's another to live it in your heart. And so we're going to just go through these very quickly to give God another opportunity to persuade our hearts. 1 John 4:17 says, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. That means right now, y'all, not in the sweet by and by. John 17:16, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal to God. God wants that mind in us. Wow. Now, like I said, the first time Greg said that, I just about flipped out. But that is God's desire. He wants our minds and our hearts to be filled with the fact that we are equal to God. Not because of our flesh, though. Not because of what we do. Not because of what we have. But because that's the way he made us. So if we have seen Jesus, then we have seen ourselves. Right? If we have seen Jesus, we have seen ourselves. Now, I'm sure that in each one of us, there's a little part in our hearts that's grabbed a hold of it. But then there's the other part of our hearts that haven't been persuaded yet. And I know it because God wouldn't have me be preaching this. So we could all hear it again. And me at the top of the list. You know, we need to hear it again and again. Each time we hear it, God is persuading our hearts over and over and over again. So if we've seen Jesus, we've seen ourselves. Why do we have a problem with that? Why is it that our whole heart can't just grab a hold of that and say, yes? It's because we're still judging ourselves according to the flesh. That's the only reason. We are good. God is good. But God doesn't love us because he's good. He loves us because we're good. God loves you because you're lovely. He couldn't help but do anything else but love you and treasure you because he sees who you really are. He showed us Jesus and him resurrected to help us get a picture of what we are and what we look like. God never saw Jesus bad or evil when he was hanging on the cross, did he? No. He saw Jesus as his beautiful, lovely, perfect son caught in a web that was going to kill him. That's what he saw. He saw his precious son dying the death that this wrong belief system produced. Whose sin was Jesus dying in? It was our sin. Did God despise Jesus or refuse to help Jesus because the sin of the world was on him? No. Did God think Jesus was bad when he was in all that sin? No. The man that hung on the cross was worthy of sitting at God's right hand. The man that hung on the cross was worthy of sitting at God's right hand. Who did the man on the cross represent? Us. He represented you and he represented me. We are worthy to sit at God's right hand. In John 8:15, Jesus told the Pharisees, and this is when they brought the woman caught in adultery to Jesus. Jesus said, you judge after the flesh. They looked at what the woman did and they wanted to judge her. By what? The Ten Commandments. They wanted to judge her by that system. But Jesus would have no part of it because Jesus didn't judge men according to the flesh. He does not judge you according to the flesh. Jesus sees you as a part of himself, one with him from the beginning of time, equal with him in the Trinity. He never saw man as bad or faulty. He only saw us as captives and victims to a wrong belief system, without the ability to save ourselves. So how can we be sure that God sees us as one with him, holy and not according to the flesh? We can't do anything. That's the good news. It's all on him. He's going to persuade our hearts. He's going to persuade your heart over and over and over again. Every time somebody says something bad about you, every time you say something bad about yourself, every time you think something bad about yourself, the Holy Spirit is going to be right there, wooing you to his belief system. I know, because it's happening to me. It's happening to me. Now, there used to not be a choice. I mean, there was a choice, but I didn't know there was a choice. When I did something wrong, there was only one thing to believe. That's that I was rotten. But now I'm starting to hear God, and I'm hearing him say, that's a lie. That's not true. Wow. And I'm going to get into it a little bit further with the scripture. But God told me last week when I did something, he said, you didn't do it. I said, well, sure looked like I did it. Sure felt like I did it. He said, no, it was the sin. It was the devil's belief system that I was living by that did it. Man, God is really going deep to persuade our hearts that we don't need to judge ourselves according to the flesh. And he's going to persuade our hearts about why we shouldn't. So we're going to let the Word of God do a little bit more persuading this morning. In Hebrews 11, chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good report. That word it is bringing us back to faith. By faith, those people obtained a good report. They didn't obtain a good report by their works. They didn't obtain a good report by their flesh. Good thing, because they wouldn't have had a good report then, would they? No way. They got a good report by faith. Whose faith? That word faith means being persuaded. They were the recipients of the faith, not the producers of the faith. The faith did not come from them. The faith came from God. God persuaded their hearts until they could trust him. In Galatians 2:20, Paul shares with us that he didn't live by his own faith. He lived by the faith of the Son of God, and that it was God's faith that persuaded him. Galatians chapter 2, verses 20 and 21. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. The life which I now live in the flesh, meaning his body, not according to the flesh, he lived by the faith of the Son of God, who loved him and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness comes by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Righteousness doesn't even come through the law. Righteousness doesn't even come through the flesh. Why have we tried so hard to be righteous according to the flesh? And why would we ever think that God does that too? Now we're going to look at how God sees people, and we're going to look at some of these elders, and we're going to let God persuade our hearts of how he sees us. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 and 9. By faith, again, not Abraham's faith, but God persuading his heart, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should, after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith, he sojourned into the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. Now remember, that word faith means he was persuaded. He was convinced by the faith of the Son of God. God's faith came and persuaded him and persuaded him and persuaded him until he could trust God. Then it says Abraham obeyed. When you look up that word obeyed, it means that he heard. Abraham eventually, I don't know if he got it the first time or it took 100 or 1,000 times. God never stops, so it doesn't matter how many times it takes. But he heard. He had ears to hear. And it says that that word means he listened attentively and he understood. So when Abraham heard what God said to him, he was persuaded by God's faith that he could trust God. Now remember, God does not see people according to Satan's belief system. He does not see them according to the flesh. He sees everyone through his belief system. All it mentions in these scriptures about all these elders is how they were persuaded by faith and that they had a good report and they obeyed God. Not one time. This always, you know, it always boggled my mind before I started coming to this church, It always boggled my mind why these people look so good and why all that God had to say was good stuff about them. There's no mention of all the times that Abraham tried to get life in his own strength. Not at all. Just like God, I don't know, had blinders on or something. There is no mention of the time that Abraham gave his wife to Pharaoh to be put in Pharaoh's harem. Let's look at that. Genesis chapter 12, verses 12 and 13. Now, this is Abraham talking to Sarah. Therefore, it shall come to pass when the Egyptians shall see thee, that they shall say, this is his wife, and they will kill me, but they will save thee alive. Say, I pray thee, that thou art my sister, that it may be well with me, for thy sake, and my soul shall live because of thee. Well, it might go well for Abraham, but what about Sarah? Goodness gracious. So here we see Abraham trying to get life from his own strength. It's definitely a work of the flesh, y'all. Now, God was very good to them, and he got Sarah out of that pickle. Did I mention that Abraham gave his wife to another man, another king? King Abimelech. God came to Abraham and Sarah again and rescued them in Genesis 20, verse 6, by coming to Abimelech in a dream and told him that Sarah was really Abraham's wife. So God comes to Abraham and Sarah with compassion and help. He is not judging them according to the flesh. He sees that they're caught in the wrong belief system, and he just wants to help them get out. He sees them without fault because he never judged them according to the flesh. Now, we're going to look at a time when Abraham comes up with a master plan to protect his life. In Genesis chapter 20, verse 13, he tells Sarah, he clues her in on his plan. And it came to pass when God caused me, meaning Abraham, to wander from my father's house, that I said unto her, meaning Sarah, this is thy kindness which thou shalt show unto me. At every place whither we shall come, say of me, he is my brother. Every place they went, Abraham set his wife up to be in whoever's harem. First of all, that's a lie, right? She was his wife. And to top it off, that put his wife in a really horrible, horrible life. So Abraham was going to put her into a horrible life so he could save his life. Okay, now we can look at Abraham and go, what was wrong with that guy? But you know what? We try to find life for ourselves all the time too. We just don't realize it. And we do it more than twice, and more than three times, and more than four times. And if we're living in the wrong belief system, it causes us to feel guilt and shame, regret and condemnation. But these works of the flesh aren't even mentioned in the book of Hebrews. God only sees Abraham as a man of faith with a good report, because God never saw Abraham according to the flesh. God's never seen you according to the flesh either. He only sees you as you truly are. There's no need for guilt or shame or regret or condemnation. It also doesn't mention Abraham's response to God when God tells him that he would give he and Sarah a child. That's in Genesis 17, verses 16 through 18. And God said, "And I will bless Sarah and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be of her." Abraham, in response to God's persuasion, falls on his face and laughs and said in his heart, "Shall a child be born unto him that is 100 years old? And shall Sarah that is 90 years old bear?" And Abraham says unto God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before thee. Oh, God, I want you to come into my system of life. I want you to enter into my works of the flesh. I want you to enter into Satan's belief system." Wow, isn't that amazing? And yet, every time we're looking at ourselves according to the flesh, that's exactly what's going on in us also. But you know, none of that was recorded in Abraham's report, because God never knew him in that way. God only knows us according to the faith of the Son of God, as we truly are. We're going to look at one more very quickly. Hebrews 11, chapter 11, verse 31. "By faith the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, when she had received the spies with peace." Here we see both belief systems side by side. We see Rahab in God's belief system by faith. She's judged by faith in God's belief system. And then we see her judged in the devil's belief system, which she's called a harlot. According to the flesh. That's not what God saw. God never saw that. Her actions according to the flesh didn't exclude her, because her actions according to the flesh were not seen. It wasn't who she even was. It goes on in verse 32. And says, What shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, of David also and Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith, no actions, no works of the flesh, through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, and stopped the mouths of lions. None of those people were known according to their works or their behavior, but according to faith. According to whose faith? God's faith. The faith of the Son of God. Do you remember being taught that when you get up to heaven, God's going to have this big old 3D screen that's, you know, 100 miles long, and it's going to show all the bad things you did in your life? Where did that come from? I think we all know now, right? That's like saying Satan's belief system is in heaven. And not only that, but God's using it. I mean, my goodness, how come we didn't realize that? Because the flesh system felt so normal to us, because we had not been persuaded by the faith of the Son of God yet. But as we continue to be more and more persuaded, God showed me that we'll get to a place where Satan's belief system, when we hear any part of it, it'll be like fingernails going down a chalkboard. It is just gonna, we're not gonna be able to stand it. And that's the place he's taken us to, that we will know ourselves as he knows us. If God gave everything he had to free us from that belief system, why would he put a full screen movie about us in the flesh? There is no way. It never was God's view of us that needed to be changed. God never had a sin-stained conscience. It was us. We were the ones that needed to have our belief system changed. When the scribes and the Pharisees brought the woman caught in adultery to Jesus to pass judgment on her, he found no fault in her. Isn't that good? Then he told her to go and not find any fault in herself. Go and sin no more. Was he talking about her actions? No way. Because he didn't know her according to the flesh, did he? No. He was talking about go and don't let yourself be caught in that wrong belief system that says you're worthless. Go and no longer judge yourself by your behavior, but believe what I say about you. God never knew you by your sin. All he saw is beauty. The same beauty that we see when we see Jesus sitting at the right hand of God. God sent Jesus to show us that we never were bad. God wants us to see ourselves the way he sees us. I'm going to let us get a little glimpse of what God sees when we judge ourselves according to the flesh. I'm going to read from the Amplified Version. I usually always read from King James, but this was just a little bit easier to understand, and it stayed true to what God was saying. Romans chapter 17, verses 15 and 16. This is Paul talking about the effects of the wrong belief system. What happens when you live in the wrong belief system? For I do not understand my own actions. I am baffled, bewildered. Have you ever felt like that? Have you ever done something and you just can't believe you did it? You didn't want to do it. In fact, it was the last thing you wanted to do, and that's the thing you did. Like when I ate that candy bar. I really didn't want to eat that candy bar. I wanted to prove to God and myself that I love God more. I do not practice or accomplish what I wish, but I do the very thing that I loathe, which my moral instinct condemns. Now, if I do habitually, notice that habitually, that means it's an ongoing thing, what is contrary to my desire, that means that I acknowledge and agree that the law is good and that I take sides with it. Verse 17 and 18. However, it is no longer I who do the deed, but the sin principle which is at home in me and has possession of me. That's why God never saw us according to the flesh. Because it isn't us doing it. It's the sin principle. It's the wrong belief system that has us trapped. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. There we go, the flesh is weak. I can will to do what is right, but I cannot perform it. I have the intention and urge to do what is right, but no power to carry it out. Verse 19 and 20. For I fail to practice the good deeds I desire to do. Oh my gosh, How many of us on January 1st had a new plan, New Year's resolutions? I'm not gonna whatever. Right. For I fail to practice the good deeds I desire to do, but the evil deeds that I do not desire to do are what I am ever doing. Now, if I do what I do not desire to do, it is no longer I doing it. It is not myself that acts, but the sin principle which dwells within me. Paul describes that as a wretched man. That's what God saw. He didn't see us bad. He saw us caught in a belief system that made the works of the flesh manifest in our lives. Not us, the sin principle. That was the evil thing. That was the bad thing. Not you. God sees that we're caught up in the system and that we can't do the things that we want to do. And the very things that we want to do, we aren't able to do. God sees you and me like that beautiful butterfly, perfect, complete, the very image of Him, caught in a trap, a belief system that brought death. His only desire is to free us from that system by persuading us and by assuring us over and over again about who we really are, so that we can be free from this system, and so He can bring us into His life and His faith in the Godhead where you belong. Now, He already set us free from that system when He died on the cross and was raised from the dead. Before that, mankind didn't have a choice. Now we have a choice. And when we accept that who we are is just like Jesus and that Jesus took care of everything for us, we enter into God's life. But it's not over, is it? Because we've lived in this wrong belief system for so long. And so even though we're really free from it, we're still in that good fight of faith, believing what God says about us when the world presses in. Think about when kids go to school. You know, sometimes we think that kids don't have problems. Man, I don't think there's very many people that go to work and somebody goes, look, you've got a zit. Why do you wear those stupid clothes? I mean, come on. That's what kids deal with when they go to school. Their identity is being torn down at a very early age. In their neighborhoods, the world presses in all the time. God wants to set us free from that. God wants to persuade our hearts so fully that it doesn't matter what anybody says to you. It doesn't matter what you have or don't have. It doesn't matter what happens to you. It doesn't matter what work of the flesh you see manifest in your life, that you cannot be budged off of what God says about you. That's the place that He's taking us to. A place of total freedom. A place of total joy. A place where we don't have guilt and we don't have shame. God says to you, you are beautiful. You are worthy. You are His bride without spot or wrinkle. You are the God kind. He says He never found fault with you. He never found fault with you. Father, I thank You that Your vision is perfect. I thank You, God, that You don't have any kind of vision problems and that Your vision is the right one. What You see about us is the truth. I thank You that You are day and night while we're awake and while we're sleeping, that You are persuading our hearts of this truth. I thank You, Father, that You feel right at home with us because we are just like You. Amen.